Everything that off the John need, oh baby. Yeah, baby. And that is, let me repeat that, that's 678-215-1961. So every day, every Tuesday, we begin with an exercise demonstration. So as John has mentioned, he said something about water bottles, get a chair. He said something about construction. So we just want to get your heart going. We want to get that blood flow going. What's good for your heart is good for your brain. So be ready, get ready. We're still waiting for one more panelist to join us. Today, you're going to hear from Dr. Monica Parker. She's going to talk about dementia domains. And so get ready to take notes. Then we're going to talk about caregiving from a distance. And Dr. Hepburn is going to address and provide some strategies if you are having to be a caregiver and you're having to do that from a distance. In this time, that can be a challenge. So we want to equip you, we want to empower you, we want to give you tips. And then Dr. Wharton is going to talk about cognition and the implications around your sleep and the lack of sleep. And a lot of us, our sleep patterns have absolutely changed during this time. I can admit to that. And so we want to address sleep, and she's going to talk about sleep. Then we will close out again. We're in this time of COVID-19, so we always want to close out with giving you some tips. And Dr. Parker is going to address testing. We know testing is up and the cases are up. And now that sort of, you know, our state, we're in Georgia, is open, we still want to keep you apprised of what's going on and what's happening here at Emory. And Crystal Johnson, who is the infection control manager, has been bringing us great information each week. And so she's been pulled to, again, address that as Emory begins to establish protocols and guidelines. So she continues to provide that input. And so we will be sharing that today with you. So thank you all for joining us. We welcome each and every one of you. We appreciate you for being here. And with that, John, I am going to turn it over to you.
All right. Remember, today we're going to do construction. We're going to work on that entire body, that back. We're going to do some rehab motions. But before we get started, let's get that body, that blood flowing. So get your space and let's get going. All right. Get them going. Like you hit those drums. Any copper tone, we get it. Shoulders, let's go. Party back. Come on. Tap. Cross it. Tap. Tap. Let go. Tap. 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 Boom. Hit the drum, boom. Come on. Over. Come on. Good job. We got that arm going. Now I just want you to feel happy. Let's go. Come on. There we go. We get those abs. Close them. Let's go. Rock it down. Come on. Can I get those abs? Can I get those abs? Let's go. Woo! And no. Come on now. Three. Okay, now we're about to do some technical building and some construction. Let's start with the shoulders. Forward, back, forward, back, forward, back. Let's get those side obliques and we're gonna work that spine. Here we go, and come on. Boom, 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 boom. Rest. Let me get a little turn. Come on, we're doing construction right now. We're toning that body. We're getting those abs. And good. Let's take it a little bit further. Bring that leg up at an angle and twist. Come on. I told you we're doing major construction today. Good job of the leg. There we go. We about to finish up. Come on. Good job. I'm gonna grab my water bottle, my jug today. Y'all ready? Let's go. I need those abs. There we go. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Good. Let's get back. There we go. Boom. Good job. One more. Good job. Other side. Good job. Let me get these box up. Let me get these box up. Let's go. And good job. I want to leave y'all with two stretches and we're done. Two stretches, right leg straight, reach and down. Reach and down. We're stretching those glutes, those hamstrings, and we're keeping that blood flowing. Good, other leg, let's go. Stretch. If you have any sciatic nerve problems, we need to stretch that out. There we go, good. One more, let's get that more back. Down and up. We're stretching those hip flexors, that back, those glutes, and good. Okay, let's go right to left. Boom. Come back straight. Now we're isolating different parts of the lower back and giving a nice stretch. We're stretching those outer glutes, those high hips. There we go, good. Can I get your hands out and just lean over. Stretch those legs, stretch them. This is the most important thing in the morning. At night, trust me, you'll get a better sleep. Good. I want to say thank you. All of y'all be happy about life during this pandemic, but make sure you just stay happy. I'm John Lewis, and see you later. Bye.
All right. Thank you, John. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It's always a pleasure to have him. He's been working with us since 2015, and we just enjoy all of his energy and just the great tips he gives. He's on all the social media outlets, so if you want to follow him and have a more extended time period with him, I think a couple of times a month, he offers these sessions for 30 or 45 minutes. So we're just giving you a teaser and we just want to keep encouraging you to stay fit, stay healthy, stay at home. So next up we have Dr. Monica Parker, and give me just a sec. I'm going to pull up her PowerPoint. But Dr. Parker, if you want to go ahead and introduce your topic for today.
Good afternoon, and thank you again for joining us. One of the things that we're talking about today.
We're getting an echo on your end.
On my end?
Mm-hmm.
What we can do about that. That better?
Keep talking, let's see.
Not how to make it. Not better. That better? I have two devices that are both making noise, so I'm trying to figure it out.
I would, if you have it on your phone, I would mute your phone or turn the volume down on your phone. Or mute your computer and keep your phone on.
Are we better?
I still hear an echo.
Give me a minute. All right, I'll tell you what. In any event, we're going to talk about what gives you a diagnosis of dementia. We're all familiar with Alzheimer's, and we may be familiar with some of the other different dementias. Okay, so at base, there are several different types of dementias, now referred to as neurocognitive disorders. It's a spectrum of disorders, but they all relate to degeneration or deterioration of the neurologic system, okay? Of the different types, just for a refresher, we have most commonly diagnosed Alzheimer's, followed by a combination of Alzheimer's and or an other dementia like vascular disease, mixed, which is Alzheimer's and vascular, which has to do with strokes, Lewy body, which is a different pathology, accumulation of different parts, different artifacts that accumulate in a different part of the brain, frontotemporal, which is shrinkage of the frontal part of your brain, Parkinson's disease, alcoholic encephalopathy, and chronic traumatic encephalopathy. Now, the thing that's significant about all of these is you have deficits in how your brain functions. Your brain has several things that it helps you do besides memory. So we're going to talk about what some of those things are. In our department, or when you come to Emory for an evaluation for dementia, you're going to have testing done. Hopefully before you've gotten here, your doctor has sent your MRI, showed us that all your laboratories and all your medical problems are stable. So when we get here, when you get here, we're going to do a testing, neuropsychologic testing, which is generally done by a clinical psychologist, not a medical doctor, but a PhD neuropsychologist. And they're going to be testing how your brain functions. And what we do when we do this neuropsych testing is we measure brain function in what we call domains. So what are the different domains that your brain works in? Well, we all know about memory and learning. So that's one domain. Next slide, please. Another domain is something called complex attention, executive function. Go to the next one. Perceptual motor, okay, which is, okay, all right. Here are domains, six key domains that are measured when you come for neuropsych testing. Deficits in functioning in any two of these different brain functions gives you a diagnosis of dementia. So what are they? Complex attention, which is the ability to attend to or manage and process different stimuli. Right now, you may be looking at the computer, you may be listening. You're also looking at the pictures, trying to understand what's going on. Executive function, which is the ability to plan, to organize, to complete tasks and projects. Following a map, as an example, is a type of executive function, figuring out a pattern. like a puzzle. Learning and memory, okay, remembering items, remembering people, events, things like that, procedures. Something like remembering how to golf, for example. That's a learned process, okay? Perceptual motor is being able to manipulate your physical body to do some of the things that you want it to do, okay? I want to move from point A to point B. I'm looking at people's faces. I'm looking at different colors. I want to pick up a pen to write a note. That's a perceptual motor activity. Language, I am using the right words to communicate a message to you. I am understanding what you are saying to me. And then social cognition, which is doing socially appropriate behaviors and things in socially appropriate places, decision making. It may be things like remembering to cover your mouth when you cough, those kinds of things. So there's six domains: complex attention, executive function, learning and memory, perceptual motor, language, and social cognition. Those are all areas of brain function that when you have deficits in two or more of those areas, you're going to be given a diagnosis of dementia. So it doesn't really matter what kind of dementia you have. It means that you have difficulty doing all of these things or any two of these things. Deficits in two or more areas of brain function or domain gives you a diagnosis of dementia. Next. I think that, I guess that's my last slide there.
Right.
In any event, it's important that you understand that a lot of these neurocognitive functions are measured by a psychologist, but not a medical doctor. So a clinical neuropsychologist is somebody who will evaluate and test for these things. Another domain here that I didn't put in here, but it is very important, has to do with your emotions. One of the things that the neuropsychologists test for and basically give objective evidence for is depression or mood disorders as well. But deficits in two or more of the things on this page give you a diagnosis of dementia. And depending upon what the deficit is, we work on that. You may or may not work on that. But the end result is people, as all of these brain functions deteriorate and progress, the individual is gradually unable to care for him or herself and requires caregiving and assistance with all of those functions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parker. And I think the nugget that I heard is it's two of these domains or more, correct?
Two or more.
Okay. And these domains, you said a psychologist.
A neuropsychologist.
A neuropsychologist is the one that conducts this test.
Right.
And so a couple of weeks ago, Dr. Parker talked about how to get a proper diagnosis. She also talked about screening, and last week we shared about your annual wellness visit. Is this a routine test, Dr. Parker, that occurs?
No, neurocognitive disorder testing, like the neuropsych testing we're talking about here, is something that when you go to the neuropsychologist, it will take you anywhere from 1 to 4 hours to complete. In the course of a primary exam, if you came to see me and I was doing a screening for dementia, the little memory test, the little memory screening evaluations that we do, whether it's a mini cog test, like an item recall, a clock drawing test, those are screening tools. Those are not diagnostic. Those really mean that there may be a problem here, but I don't know what the problem is. For women, if you go to, you have a mass you feel in your breast, you know that it's there. You don't know what it is until you do more testing. So the neuropsych test gives us an understanding of why our screening test that we did in the doctor's office was abnormal.
All right. Okay. And so thank you. We wanted to, again, profile some of the other components and elements that go into diagnostic testing. So this sort of gives you a bird's eye view of what doctors are using to properly evaluate people who suspect that they have memory issues. So now we're going to switch gears. Every week we feature a caregiving aspect. And so Dr. Hepburn is our subject matter expert when it comes to this issue. And Dr. Parker, there are a couple of questions in the Q&A. If you do not mind addressing those, thank you. Okay, give me one sec. I'm going to pull up Dr. Hepburn so that you can see him. Hello, hello.
Hi there. Can you all see and hear me? Cornelia, can you hear me?
I can hear you. You're coming through very clear.
Oh, great. Well, I just welcome everyone once again. Someone had asked this question about what does one do as a distance caregiver? And I thought, what a great question, because in point of fact, there's probably more distance caregivers than there are in-person caregivers. There are about maybe 7 million people in America who live with disorders such as those that Dr. Parker spoke of. And generally speaking, we think there are maybe close to 20 million people who are providing care, family and friends. So distance caregiving is not unusual. And I wanted to start by talking about different types of distance caregiving, just so we sort of have some categories in mind. So I think one kind is where you are actually the primary caregiver, but not living with the person. So that's primary caregiving, not go back to that slide. Then there's secondary caregiver who lives in town. You know, the sister or the daughter who lives in town while another sister or another parent is taking care of the person as the primary caregiver. And then there are people who live far away, out of town caregivers who may be in fact primary caregivers or maybe secondary caregivers. So let's sort of keep those in mind and as we walk through. So next slide, ma'am. In every case, as a distance caregiver, I think there really needs to be a very clear conversation, clear set of agreements. The plans for contingencies are in place. You need to think about the COVID-linked advanced care plans. Okay, so if you're the secondary caregiver or the distant primary caregiver, you really have to either negotiate with the primary or think through yourself or with the care recipient, what should happen? What would happen if the person acquired the virus, became really ill, went to the hospital, and the physician said, we need to make a choice about putting your mom, dad on a ventilator or putting her or him in the ICU. Is that choice to go on a ventilator, which almost 80% of the time the person doesn't come off that prior to death, is that what the person would have wished? You should think that through in advance. Think through in advance when and under what circumstances you would and how you might add outside help to a caregiving situation. When does the primary caregiver think, this may be too much for me to handle, I'm going to need some help? As a secondary caregiver, you need to be part of that decision. You need to help reinforce it and inform it. In advance, what if the primary caregiver needs to be hospitalized? How is the secondary caregiver going to act in that circumstance? And if the care recipient needs to be hospitalized, what's the plan? So these things ought to be talked about in place. If there's a secondary caregiver in the picture, she or he and the primary caregiver need to have these. This is a crucial, critical conversation. Okay, next. Next slide, please. So suppose you're primary and not co-residing. You're a daughter taking care of your mom who's living alone in the same town. Presumably, there's sufficient capacity in the person living with the illness to be able to have a conversation about what's the safety plan? What is the personal safety plan here? Can you get the person to agree on the conditions under which she or he will leave the house? will it be to go shopping? And if so, how's that going to happen? Is the person going to drive herself there? What if there are deliveries coming into the house? What steps is the person taking to ensure that those are safe from an infection control perspective? And similarly, if there are others, for example, help, care help, coming into the home, what measures are in place to ensure that they are not bringing the infection with them? You have as primary, but not co-residing, caregiver to think about cabin fever that the person may be experiencing. Social isolation is keeping us all further apart, keeping us in the house more. So there's likely increased need for contact, for more contact due to this increased isolation. So how can you do that? Can you add more virtual contact time? Can you add more actual? Can you come into the home more frequently for longer periods? Or if not, can you augment those with some kind of, you know, Zoom conversation or FaceTime or Skype, just to keep the person engaged with another person, namely you? And then as the primary caregiver, you're going in and out of this house, almost certainly, and probably on a daily basis or nearly so. So you have to have a plan. What are you going to do when you enter? How are you going to sanitize yourself? Absolute religiosity around hand washing. And consider doing what some people do, which is actually have clothing in the house that, into which they will change from the clothing that they wore when entering. Keep those entry clothes and exit clothes someplace separate and put on what are essentially clean clothes while being in the environment. The next slide, please. So whether you're near or distance and are a secondary caregiver, a number of things to do. First is call a truce, okay? All unhappy families are unhappy in their own unique way. And there is conflict in virtually every family. You gotta set that aside right now, if at all possible. I mean, there needs to be a conversation that starts something like, I know you and I have had our disagreements, but in this time we gotta come together to help so-and-so. So call a truce. Then go over those contingency plans and affirm them. Look, if you're the secondary caregiver, if there's somebody else providing care, that person's kind of taking the lead. You can either, as a secondary, get into a sort of fist fight around that, or recognize that you might be able to provide some augmentation to the plan, but under all circumstances, try and recognize and affirm the primary caregiver needs support and provide that support. You can brainstorm about task and activity design. The primary caregiver is sort of making the day happen. Kind of think with her or him, what did mom or dad used to like to do? What was he good at? Did you try doing this? Did you try doing this? Tell me what you do to keep him occupied. And let's think together about things that you might be able to do to keep her occupied. And then reassess your own contributions to the care. What can you add? Maybe you can be the person who adds virtual contact. Even though the caregiver is there and has contact, you can provide yet another person through FaceTime or Zoom with whom the care recipient can have contact. The other important role you can play as secondary caregiver is to be the release valve for the primary caregiver. You know, let's have a conversation. Tell me how you're feeling. This must be tough on you. What can I do to help? Acknowledge the fact that there's pressure already, and now with COVID is added pressure. So you can be the pressure release valve. Maybe you can add to the material and financial support you're already providing. Think about that. If you're an in-town secondary caregiver, you can maybe up your role as a delivery service. You can be the person bringing in those takeout meals or going shopping or things like that. So think about augmenting what you're already doing. And then I think the last slide's coming up. Is there another? Yeah. So if you're the, if, and this is not unheard of, if you're the primary caregiver at a distance, you live in, you know, San Antonio and your dad is here in Atlanta, certainly try to make whatever contracts you can with the person about future state issues. When can I, you know, help you with your finances? Let's talk about when you're going to stop driving. How are you handling shopping? Can we think of some alternatives? Is there a way I can order online for you and have, you know, Kroger or Publix deliver to your home? Where possible, increase the help that you provide. So again, more, you know, how often do you call the person? How often do you speak with them? Can you up that game? Can you be more present? Because again, the person's isolated. She's living all alone. Given COVID, the isolation is greater. So the need for contact is greater. See if you can provide that. And take over certain responsibilities that may be appearing to be confusing or overwhelming. I think most important, maybe not most importantly, but very importantly, is take responsibility for assuming greater control in the future. So for sure, ensure designation as a healthcare surrogate. I would say get the power of attorney, legal power of attorney. Listen to what the lawyer, Danielle Humphrey, talked about, all the scams out there. If you can maybe help by getting control of the person's finances, you can avoid those kinds of things. Establish the link with the person's primary care provider and establish your own standing. Look, I'm the surrogate. I need to talk. I need to be involved in these conversations. Really important, there are professional geriatric case managers. If you can identify and afford a reliable geriatric case manager in the person's area, make that contact now. Work with that person to in advance to identify home care and institutional care options that you might draw on when the time comes. So I think I'm out of time, but those would be my tips for the day.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Hepburn. The one thing, resounding theme that I heard was the personal safety plan or personal care plan. Any closing thoughts?
I think especially during COVID, but even without COVID, a person living with a dementing illness is at increased risk for accident. And now cannot self-protect against the kind of contacts that might lead to the invasion of the virus. And so that extra vigilance around personal safety, but also infection control, I just think is ought to be uppermost in our minds.
Absolutely. All right. Well, thank you. And check the chat in the Q&A. Next, we are going to share some insight with you from Dr. Whitney Warden. She's going to talk about, she's going to close her session with sleep, but she's also going to highlight the risk for women when it comes to Alzheimer's disease. So Dr. Warden, I'm going to try to enlarge your screen here and stop my share. There you go. I see, what is that in your background?
It's flashing. I'm sorry. I should probably get rid of that. I do so many Zoom meetings during the day. I switched it because I,
Is that a neuron?
That is the coronavirus.
That's the corona. You're being attacked.
It is a corona, so yes. Thank you so much. And I would like to follow up. I really just thoroughly enjoyed what Dr. Hepburn said. And I think there were so many really helpful tidbits there, especially they were really helpful for me as a secondary caregiver for my mother who does not have dementia, but has breast cancer. And she lives in Texas. And I, of course, live in Atlanta. And just a few things that he said really sort of resonated with me. And I'm going to talk about women's increased risk for dementia and also end a little bit with sleep. But I just wanted to reiterate, as someone being, you know, a caregiver from a distance, that some of the things that he said was so helpful, and just being in that situation, as I know many of you are, and many of you are primary caregivers, and you probably have, you know, siblings or family members from afar that are trying to help, or you are trying to help them. What really struck with me was that, you know, Dr. Hepburn said, you know, putting maybe family differences aside and just trying to do what you can do, especially in this time, because this is, as many of you know, a really difficult time for primary caregivers, especially if they are not able to see their loved one, or if their loved one is in their home 24/7 and they're living with them and maybe unable to work. It's just a really difficult time. What I've found has been really helpful for me personally is sometimes, you know, when I ask my father what he needs for my mother when, you know, she's going through radiation or chemo or just having a few really bad days, is sometimes I'll ask him, you know, what he needs, and he doesn't really know the answer because he hasn't had time to think about it. So I will just send, you know, I'll order groceries for him or order dinner for the night or contact a neighbor that I know is close and they can bring something over. And that seems to be really helpful. So sometimes if you just sort of take the initiative and do it, then that can be, I have found, really helpful. And they are so thankful later just to have any sort of respite for the night. I think that that's really helpful. And, you know, I think this is just a really difficult time for caregivers. And so, you know, I will echo everything that he said. And kind of the one thing that you can do too that really stuck with me with what Dr. Hepburn said is, you know, anything that you can do to be a relief for the primary, whether that is, you know, sending groceries or sending a dinner or calling a neighbor or just a conversation with the primary caregiver and just check in with them and say, how are you feeling and how are you doing and are you eating properly and are you having any time to yourself? Is there anything I can do? But I really just wanted to check in because I'm thinking about you too, because I think caregivers often are so, you know, whether, you know, caring for our parent with dementia, our spouse with dementia, or or with any disease for that matter. And then also children in the home, there's job complications right now. And a lot of people are filing for unemployment. It's just a really stressful time. So I think caregivers just need kind of a check-in, and just asking someone if they're okay, I think goes a long way. Even if you're not able to send groceries or do anything, I think just entering into that dialogue is something, because I think primary caregivers oftentimes don't have time to think about themselves. I also, my personal research, excuse me, is only with caregivers, and I've never had anyone in my office or any of my study participants or patients come in and say that that they don't feel isolated and they don't feel alone, because you don't want to complain about your role. You want to be respectful of your loved one with dementia or another disorder. And, you know, you don't want to make it seem like that person is a burden on you, but, you know, everyone needs time to themselves and everyone needs a check-in. And, you know, being a caregiver is in and of itself a risk factor for dementia because of things that I've talked about before, and I'll talk about a little bit today. So I think just making them, if they're not able to convey it to you, but just making them think about that themselves is really important. So I really enjoyed that presentation. So thank you, Dr. Hepburn, for that. So I have a few lines of research and a few things I wanted to talk about. And one is women's and the disproportionate number of women that are affected by dementia and Alzheimer's compared to men. There's a couple of reasons for this. So what we used to think is that women are disproportionately affected by Alzheimer's disease versus men because simply we live longer. On average, we tend to live longer than men. And because age is the number one risk factor for Alzheimer's disease, we used to kind of just attribute it to age, which we know now isn't necessarily true, but it's definitely a contributing factor. The second is that women on average tend to be caregivers more so than men. So we, you know, go through our lives, you know, oftentimes in comparison to men on average, being the primary caregiver for our children. And we, you know, take on all of those responsibilities like feeding them, helping them with homework. There's more people on average, again, this is not across everybody, but more people that are likely to stay at home and take care of others for that are women. And then this also happens when we get older. So even though women are more likely to get Alzheimer's disease, people that are caring for individuals with Alzheimer's or dementia tend to be women. Because women, again, just are good at and assume that sort of caregiving role. And we care for, you know, of course, our children and our spouses, but also our parents, particularly in the African-American community. The most common caregiver for a dementia patient is the first or second born daughter of that individual with Alzheimer's or dementia. And that kind of gets to my third point, because if you are caring for someone with dementia, you know, you're probably, you know, a middle-aged, like myself, individual, so probably between, you know, 40 and 55 years old. And there's a lot of things that happen in the female body, particularly menopause, between that time frame. And these changes that happen in our own bodies have biological and physiological effects that impact our own health. And so while we're spending time taking care of others, there's things that happen with our body that sometimes are neglected because we're so busy taking care of others around us. So before a woman goes through menopause, which is also called the change, which is when a woman stops having her period and, you know, is no longer able to reproduce, a woman, the major circulating hormone in a woman's body is called estradiol, which is a certain form of estrogen. And then after menopause or during menopause, a woman will stop producing estradiol, which is what makes you stop having your period. And she will start to produce estrone, which is a different form of estrogen in comparison to estradiol. So the physiology of our body just naturally changes. It happens to everyone. It doesn't matter if you have natural menopause or surgical menopause. It's just a natural change that happens. And what we know is that in regard to Alzheimer's disease, estradiol, which again is the type of estrogen that's produced before you go through menopause, is really good for your brain. And not only is it really good for your brain in its entirety, but it's really good for your brain in the areas called the hippocampus that are responsible for these changes that are associated with Alzheimer's disease. So that's why women, when we go through the change, we start having, you know, memory complaints, we'll have menopausal symptoms like trouble sleeping, we'll have night sweats, and we will have, you know, mood changes that aren't necessarily negative, but they're not what we had, you know, in our 30s and early 40s. So, you know, all of these changes happen and they are related to Alzheimer's disease. We have a new study that's starting up at Emory as soon as we're able to safely reopen, which is funded by the National Institutes of Health and the National Institute on Aging, which is going to directly look at the impact of circulating sex hormones in the brain, estrogen, estradiol and estrone, and see how these things might affect the Alzheimer's disease pathology, which again is the plaques and tangles that many of you have heard about. So those three things really, you know, age, older age, the lifelong, you know, caregiving, and then the menopausal transition are three of the main reasons that women are disproportionately affected by Alzheimer's disease in comparison to men. I will also say, just piggybacking a little bit on what Dr. Hepburn said, you know, with caregiving, especially with women, again, you know, the caregiving role necessitates you caring for someone else. So, you know, I had a participant a couple of months ago come into my office, and I was just having a conversation with her. And she was, you know, a middle-aged African-American woman who was caring for her parent. And I said, you know, what is your diet? What did you have for dinner last night? And she said, you know, mom really likes this, and, you know, she feels comfortable eating this, and she's having some swallowing problems. And so we tried this and this and this. And so, you know, I politely stopped her and just said, no, I asked what you were eating. You know, I want to know what you are eating. And because a lot of things that we do, especially if we're caring for others, is kind of put our own needs by the wayside. So we are less likely to exercise. We are less likely to eat properly, just because you don't have time. You're so busy caring for others that you forget to care for yourself. And it really is important to care for yourself, both because it's important for you to have, you know, an adequate diet and some semblance of exercise. But, you know, if you don't, then these are things that are going to affect your cognition later on. And, you know, the last thing that I think all of us want is someone to have to care for us like we are caring for somebody else.
And so, Dr. Wharton, you have about 2 minutes. Can you touch on sleep before we go to our next speaker? And there's a couple of comments in the chat for you too.
Absolutely. Sure thing. So I'm sorry about that. So sleep is one of those things that is neglected and becomes problematic, both in relation to, you know, women going through the menopausal transition. It's estrogen is very related to serotonin and norepinephrine and things like that in your brain that control your sleep. So I will say one thing that you can do for sleep, making sure that you go outside as much as possible. So the vitamin D that you get from the sun is actually really beneficial in helping to regulate a sleep cycle. Number two is making sure that is, you know, again, as much as possible, that you are getting some sort of exercise. So whether that's, you know, taking the stairs versus taking the elevator, or parking a little bit farther away from the store where you have to walk a little bit farther, or making a couple of circles around the car, anything that you can get your heart pumping, gardening, yoga, anything. I understand that we're all sort of quarantined to our homes right now, or I hope the vast majority of you are staying home. Anything that you can do to get your heart rate going to help your mood, and it is especially going to help your sleep. So the first thing that happens when you go for a sleep study is the physician is going to say, do you need to lose weight? What are you doing as far as your sanitation, your sleep sanitation? So, you know, your bed should be used for sleep and whatever you want to do with your partner. And then that's it. So if you cannot work, if you cannot eat, if you cannot do anything else in your bed other than sleep, you actually train your brain to know that when you're in your bed, that is time for you to go to bed. So that it doesn't seem like it would be helpful. And I know that that's like where people go into their bedroom so that they can oftentimes get separation from what they're doing in their caregiving roles. But if you can have just even a separate space in your bedroom, just a chair, if you want to work on a computer or do something in that, but like your bed is for sleep. And that really will help a little bit train your brain because, again, the physiological aspects of you know, melatonin and things like that are going to be triggered by things that you do during the day. Also, if there's things that you can do before or not do before you go to sleep. So reducing your caffeine intake before you go to sleep will significantly help. If you eat a little bit earlier, that will probably help as well, because if you eat, it speeds up your metabolism because you need to digest your food. So trying to eat a little bit earlier or eating a smaller meal later is helpful. And then again, exercise during the day, but not right before you go to sleep, because then that will get your endorphins kind of running. Then I think that those are all helpful things. And then if there's something that you can do, like if you want to read a couple of pages before a book, that again will help train your brain to know, okay, now I'm reading, now I'm going to go to sleep, and try to wake up when that is a good time.
All right. Well, thank you, Dr. Wharton. I want to remind everyone that we are recording the session, and the recording will be available tomorrow in any of the PowerPoints. So now we're going to talk about COVID-19. We can't go without sharing some insight and giving you some updates about what's going on with the virus and the pandemic. So Dr. Parker is going to share some updates with us, and she has a PowerPoint, so you all just bear with me while I bring that up. Hello, Dr. Parker. Thank you. She's been being so responsive in replying to all of your Q&A and your chat, and Dr. Wharton, if you can look in the chat as well, I know that there are some comments and remarks there. Dr. Parker, let me get your video up. And now I'm going to pull up your PowerPoint. I like your background.
I'm impressed.
I am. I'm impressed.
I have a face. Okay, so one of the things that I'm going to be talking about is who should get an antibody test versus a COVID-19 test, okay? Which is which? She's pulling that up. But suffice it to say that if you have been sick or with the typical signs of the coronavirus, so let's just review for a minute. The signs and symptoms traditionally associated with the COVID-19 virus are fever, cough, respiratory congestion, maybe some, here's the list, thank you. You should be tested for the COVID-19 infection, which is an antigen test, if you have any of the symptoms: cough, shortness of breath, fever, sore throat, chest pain, loss of taste or smell, muscle aches, chills are things that are popping up as atypical signs and symptoms. But the traditional ones are the first three: cough, shortness of breath, or fever. If you have excessive, out of the ordinary sore throat, chest pain, fatigue, or this big one down here, loss of taste or smell, and there are some gastroenterologic symptoms like excessive diarrhea that are coming around as atypical symptoms. And if you generally don't feel well, and you may have been in an environment where you were exposed to somebody with COVID-19, you should get the antigen test. Okay, that's the swab that they're using to go down your nose and look for it. The antibody test is something that you get after you have been exposed to the COVID-19 infection, and that generally indicates that you have been exposed. Okay, this is what I'm saying. Less than 10% of the patients who have more severe symptoms, the fever, the shortness of breath, and the chest pain, confusion is one of them, or inability to arouse, are allowing those. Most people don't have the most severe symptoms. Most people have less severe symptoms, and most people are recovering from those things. It's now, because COVID testing is so much more widespread now, that it's now much more available than it was a month ago or even 6 weeks ago. So if you don't have the typical symptoms, you can go and get tested, but it's best to probably wait, particularly since there's really not anything that we're going to be able to give you to treat it right this moment. Okay, just because you get a test and the test results don't indicate that you're COVID positive, you're COVID negative, does that mean you don't have the coronavirus? No, that doesn't mean that. You may test later. There is something called false negatives that
mean that people may not have, when they went for testing, they probably hadn't developed enough of an immune response to basically indicate that they have an infection. But if they go a week later, or a couple of days later, they may have a positive test. So now most facilities in here in Georgia, CVS is doing COVID testing. You have drive-through COVID testing. Emory is doing COVID testing. And the health department and most public health departments, public clinics are doing COVID-19 testing. Okay. Just because everybody hasn't been tested for the COVID-19 virus, there are people who weren't really seen by doctors, but they've gone here lately and they've gotten a COVID antibody test. And their tests are positive. What does that mean? It basically means that at some point in the past, you were exposed to the COVID-19 virus. While clinically, which means if I'm looking at you or seeing you, you don't have any of the signs and symptoms that go along with the infection or didn't have at the time, that at some point in time you were infected. This is why it is important for us to wear what we call personal protective equipment, to wear face masks to cover our nose and our mouth, because many of us don't know whether or not we have been exposed to the virus and whether or not we're carriers. So I don't feel sick, I don't look sick, but my blood is showing that I am COVID-19 positive. Does that mean I'm likely an infectious vector? Probably. But more importantly, if you have not been diagnosed, but you have symptoms, you may want to go and get tested. If you go and get tested and you find out that you've had antibodies, you know, what should you tell people? If you've done your 14-day quarantine, all that kind of thing, chances are you yourself aren't likely to get any sicker than you are right now, and you may not have generated enough antibodies to make you immune from getting it again. You've been hearing in the news that people, there's another wave coming. There may be, even if you were exposed to COVID in this interval, you may come down with it later on in the year, later in the fall or the winter of 2020. But there are more tests available to test people for COVID-19 infection, and they're testing for an antigen. The COVID antibody test basically indicates that you have been exposed to the virus. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're not going to get it in the future. It just means that you've been exposed to the virus somewhere. You may have had a minor or mild infection, but it also doesn't mean that you are not infected. So everybody needs to wear face masks. I wear a face mask when I'm out in public simply because I don't know what my COVID status is right now. I may or may not transmit respiratory droplets that have COVID-19 in them. That's why we are wearing face masks, to protect ourselves from becoming vectors and infecting other people, and we don't know whether we've been infected or not. So you can check with your primary care provider, who can advise you on where you need to go in your particular city or your county. Some local health departments, most local health departments here in Georgia, do have the capacity to do coronavirus testing. I work at Good Samaritan Health Center here in downtown Atlanta, and they are doing COVID-19 testing. So call your doctor's office, and if your doctor's office doesn't have COVID-19 testing, he or she should be able to advise you about where you can go. But also look at the local county health department, consult with your county health department to find out about where you can go. And keep in mind that having a COVID-19 antibody test doesn't mean that you're immune from ever getting the disease or that you may not get the disease in the future. Okay. And here is a symptom checker that we have here at Emory that talks about the best clinical practice, where you can go, what the CDC guidelines are, and other things. But in deference to all of this online checking, always check with your own primary care physician. If you are somebody who's living with somebody who is older, when I say older, 60 people age 65 and above are at risk, whether they're healthy or not. So in a lot of assisted livings or communities where there's a large percentage of the people that are over the age of 65 residing together, there are very strong restrictions on visiting these people, or because you could possibly bring the infection into their residence and infect a lot of into that residential facility or residential community and infect people. That's why visitation is limited. So please try to abide by those sorts of things. We've had other talks about what you can do to check in with your relatives. And as somebody who is a distance caregiver for somebody who lives in one of these residences, I check in at their front desk to find out what they're doing differently. I check in with her every day to see what she needs to deliver her care packages, if you will. But we also pick up the telephone and talk to her on a daily basis so that she knows that we're out here and we're concerned for her. Okay. Closing thoughts. With Georgia opening up businesses and people becoming more mobile, it is still more important, ever more important, that we practice safe social distancing, that we wear our face masks to reduce transmission, and do everything we can to keep ourselves from being infected. This means we have to maintain good hand hygiene. It means that we have to do a really good job of cleaning our surfaces. But most importantly, it still means that we need to kind of keep our distance. And just because we're given permission to go out and about doesn't mean that we all should. And if you are a person at risk being somebody over the age of 65, somebody who's on dialysis, somebody who's who's diabetic, somebody who is under cancer chemotherapy, you are at risk. You may feel good, but you may be out here and be in contact with somebody who's not wearing a face mask and get a corona infection or some other opportunistic infection. So please continue to practice safe health practices, wear your face masks, practice good hand hygiene, and good overall cleanliness of your respective places. I think we should still keep doing what we've been told to do, even though we're free to come out and about, doesn't mean that we should. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you, Dr. Parker. Thank you, everyone, for joining us this week. I see a lot of chat remarks and questions. So we'll stay on for a few minutes if our panelists are able to address any of those issues, especially if they're very technical. The disclaimer is check in with your primary care doctor or your specialist or your therapist or your trusted healthcare provider. So thank you. We will see you all next Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern Time for Brain Talk Live. Thank you, and we'll stay on and see if they can address the questions for a few more minutes, okay?
There was one question I thought was interesting, and that was, how do you locate a geriatric care manager? And to be honest with you, I'm not exactly sure. I would go to my healthcare provider and ask for a referral.
And I think that that's really kind of like, that's the right answer. You go see your doctor and get a referral. But most geriatric case managers in the clinic, Wesley Woods used to have a geriatric social worker. Alice Mullins kind of can provide some case management for patients coming to the outpatient cognitive clinic. But in general, most clinics don't. So there are senior advisory services can help people with housing. The Alzheimer's Association can put them in touch with people. Is also a cottage industry, geriatric case managers. They're private pay providers, and they provide a service just like everybody else does.
Yeah. The other place to go might be the Area Agency on Aging or the Adult Disabilities and Resources.
And I think we have some of that on the resource page, do we, Claudia? Yeah.
Yes. So a PDF with all the resources will go out. It's as the weeks go on, we keep adding to it. And so we send a PDF of that document along with the PowerPoints.
Great. See you all next week.
All right. Bye, guys. Thank you for joining. I'm still answering.